second lesson this morning comes from 1 Kings. It is a well-known story in which Solomon, having newly become king after his father David has died, has a dream in which God appears to him and asks what he would like God to give him. I will read chapter 2, verses 10 through 12, and then chapter 3, verses 3 through 14, which you can find on page 304 in the Hebrew Bible section of your pew Bible. Listen now for the word of the Lord. Then David slept with his ancestors and was buried in the city of David. The time that David reigned over Israel was 40 years. He reigned 7 years in Hebron and 33 years in Jerusalem. So Solomon sat on the throne of his father David, and his kingdom was firmly established. Solomon loved the Lord, walking in the statutes of his father David. Only he sacrificed and offered incense at the high places. The king went to Gibeon to sacrifice there, for that was the principal high place. Solomon used to offer 1,000 burnt offerings on that altar. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night. And God said, "Ask what I should give you." And Solomon said, "You have shown great and steadfast love to your servant, my father David, because he walked before you in faithfulness, in righteousness, and in uprightness of heart toward you. And you have kept for him this great and steadfast love and have given him a son to sit on the throne today. And now, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of my father David, although I am only a little child. I do not know how to go out or come in. And your servant is in the midst of the people whom you have chosen, a great people, so numerous they cannot be numbered or counted. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding mind to govern your people, able to discern between good and evil. For who can govern this, your great people?" It pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this. God said to him, "Because you have asked this and have not asked for yourself long life or riches or for the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern what is right, I now do according to your word. Indeed, I give you a wise and discerning mind. No one like you has been before you, and no one like you shall arise after you. I give you also what you have not asked, both riches and honor all your life. No other king shall compare with you. If you will walk in my ways, keeping my statutes and my commandments, as your father David walked, then I will lengthen your life." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Would you please pray with me? Loving God, inspire in us a true desire to know your mind. And when we fall short of that, instill in us the humility and grace to ask for help. Amen. A few years ago, when my daughter was in sixth grade, her humanities class delved deeply into a unit on ancient Chinese civilization. More than once, my husband and I marveled at all that they covered, the different dynasties that arose into and fell out of power, the Confucian education model and examination system, the Confucian social norms, rules for how people were to treat one another, and proverbs, so many proverbs. At the end of the unit came the end of unit exam. With no time to waste, it seemed like my daughter spent every minute preparing for the exam. Even in the car, she asked me to quiz her. Not being any kind of expert on what she had learned and not having my hands free to hold her book of notes, I told her that I was at a loss as to how I could quiz her in that moment. She assured me that none of that mattered. All I had to do was name a situation, any situation, and she would come up with a Chinese proverb that would appropriately address it. So I did what she told me. I named at random various situations that posed conflict or dilemma. And for each one, she conjured up an appropriate saying of ancient Chinese wisdom. Frankly, for Michael and me, it was a dream come true to hear our daughter uttering all these wise sayings that had been passed down over centuries from one generation to the next. Having named her Sophia, there are very few things that we would want more for her. I imagine that this is, in significant part, what many parents want their children to gain by being part of a church where week after week, four generations of people gather and share across the generations the wisdom gained through the ups and downs, the trials and errors of life. In addition to learning from magnificent Bible stories in which God speaks through mysterious dreams, in revelatory mountaintop moments, from blinding, burning bushes, or in the sound of sheer silence, we want our children to inherit wise instruction from ordinary people, mothers and fathers, parents and ancestors of our faith. The wisdom taught by the biblical sages does not derive from revelatory encounters with God. No, they reflect instead the common sense, the sense that the community of faith has made of its cumulative experience over the ages. I find it ironic then that in the story we read this morning, in which Solomon is undergoing a revelatory experience, being asked directly by God what more than anything else in the world he would like to be granted, Solomon requests wisdom, the very thing that arises from ordinary people for the good of ordinary people. As we know from the tradition, Solomon's wish is granted. According to the wisdom tradition of ancient Israel, Solomon was the wisest man in the whole world. Listen to the Bible's description of his wisdom. God gave Solomon very great wisdom, discernment, and breadth of understanding, as vast as the sand on the seashore, so that Solomon's wisdom surpassed the wisdom of all the people of the East and all the wisdom of Egypt. He was wiser than Ethan the Ezrahite, the Aunt Heman, Calcol and Darda, children of Mahol. His fame spread throughout all the surrounding nations. He composed 3,000 proverbs, and his songs numbered 1,005. He would speak of trees, from the cedar that is in the Lebanon to the hyssop that grows in the wall. He would speak of animals and birds and reptiles and fish. People came from all the nations to hear the wisdom of Solomon. They came from all the kings of the earth who had heard of his wisdom. Solomon wasn't alone in wanting to gain wisdom. Leaders of other nations, too, were reputedly wise. But Solomon's love of wisdom surpassed theirs. This was reflected in all the resources his administration poured into the collecting and recording of wisdom. In the ancient Near East, wisdom literature was considered a high achievement of culture. Under Solomon's rule, wisdom took the form of a cultural and intellectual movement that was supported by the state. The tremendous growth of a state bureaucracy, and with it a large number of scribes, an educational system, and a centralized judiciary, made possible the institutionalization of wisdom. During Solomon's rule, traditional wisdom sayings were rediscovered, revitalized, and recorded, as we find in the book of Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, the wisdom of Solomon. It is a remarkable legacy. It's remarkable that a state would choose to build and put to use a bureaucracy for this purpose, Interestingly, we know that Solomon was, in fact, not wise all the time. So foolish was Solomon's rule that the first recorded political event after his death was the secession of the northern tribes. Foolish policies of forced labor and taxation led to protests and the dissolution of the Davidic kingdom. Given the disastrous political consequences of these policies, it's surprising that the folklore about Solomon's wisdom stuck. Despite all evidence to the contrary, Solomon was held up long after his death as the wisest of all men. In a commentary she wrote on the book of Proverbs, biblical scholar Ellen Davis explains that the wisdom literature attributed to Solomon was literature for a people in crisis. While the rise of kingship and its accompanying bureaucracy made the collecting and recording of wisdom possible, it was probably more than coincidence that the actual formation of the book of Proverbs and the establishment of Israel's wisdom literature took place at a time when the monarchy collapsed. The crisis of Israel's collapse prompted the consolidation of Israel's wisdom literature. For those who were bewildered by change, by chaos, the time-tested wisdom of the Proverbs offered a much-needed anchor. While centuries later, nothing else from Solomon's kingdom survived, including the state itself, the wisdom that it preserved persists today. When things fall apart, we need wisdom. In the midst of chaos, we need wisdom. Remember, the source of wisdom is not revelation that comes down from on high. Wisdom comes from the bottom up. Wisdom arises from the people. Anyone can be wise. Then why is wisdom so hard to find? Especially in our current climate of populism. In an era of the internet, when more people than ever before can make their voices heard, what would it take for wisdom to arise? A week ago, I visited for the first time the Museum of the American Revolution, newly opened in Philadelphia. Telling the story of what it took for the United States of America to become the first ever country in history to be governed by the people, for the people, room after room in the museum showed the precariousness of the experiment. At so many different points in time, things could have fallen apart. The experiment could have failed had mob rule won out, had self-interest won the day, had wisdom not prevailed. Despite the tensions that were openly explored in the museum's exhibits, the planners of the museum succeeded in evoking in me a feeling of reverence for the American project. From beginning to end, I felt humbled by what people achieved by employing the wisdom of the ages, from the ancient Greek philosophers to the great thinkers of the European Enlightenment to the prophets of the Bible. In a time of political tension and stress, when Washington seems deadlocked, this feeling of reverence was remarkable to me. In a recently published book entitled The Death of Expertise, author Tom Nichols provides a succinct assessment of the mindset of our citizenry. While he acknowledges that ignorance is and always has been a problem, the bigger problem, he writes, is that we're proud of not knowing things. Americans, he goes on to say, have reached the point where ignorance, especially of anything related to public policy, is an actual virtue. To reject the advice of experts is to assert autonomy, a way for Americans to insulate their increasingly fragile egos from ever being told that they're wrong about anything. It is a new declaration of independence. End of quote. What worries Tom Nichols is that a healthy skepticism of expertise has morphed into active resentment and spread so that not just policy experts, but also doctors, lawyers, teachers, and pretty much all professionals are being told why their advice is wrong. Democracy is in danger when, as Isaac Asimov writes, "My ignorance is just as good as your knowledge," end of quote. As I was reading Tom Nichols' assessment, I was reminded of something Donald Rumsfeld said when he was Secretary of Defense under President George W. Bush. You may recall it too, explaining that he could not know for certain how long the United States would use force in Iraq. He said, "As we know, there are known knowns. These are things we know. We also know there are known unknowns. That is to say, we know there are some things we do not know. But there are also unknown unknowns, the ones we don't know we do not know." Rumsfeld went on to say, "It sounds like a riddle. It isn't a riddle. It is a very serious, important matter." Though the decision to go to war with Iraq was laced with tragedy, I appreciated these words spoken by Rumsfeld. They express the recognition that in every situation there is always something we don't know. And they reflect the humility that is critically essential if we are going to have any chance at all at being wise. Wisdom is a very serious matter. The book of Proverbs begins by saying in verse 7, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge." Fear here means less fright and more reverence. Reverence and its constitutive sense of humility, even wonder, lies at the root of wisdom. If we are committed to being a nation governed by the people, and if we are committed to free speech in all forms of media, it's even more important for wisdom to arise from the people. Fortunately, wisdom comes from all quarters and has been institutionalized in our polity and in our constitution. But unfortunately, in our daily lives, it is lacking. We act with less and less humility and feel less and less reverence. The church has a wonderful role to play in this. Here, week after week, four generations of people gather. Here we learn to walk humbly with our Lord. Here we are taught to fear, to revere the Lord. Here may we grow in wisdom. Amen.